So I am Denise Shante. I use she, her pronouns, and go by both names together. I'm a Black femme wearing tortoiseshell glasses. I have Black, short, curly hair. I'm wearing a purple top and a jade turquoise necklace. Have a tattoo sleeve. And behind me is a white wall and a pink framed piece of art. Our session is part two of Grief, Money, and Power with Kayla Carter and Carmen Galvan with the BIPOC Death and Grief Talks. What if we embody ways of being in relationship to money that value our inherent worth and dignity? And what if we carry these ways of being into our creative projects and processes? In this practice space, we're going to deepen into an exploration of these questions, bringing them into conversation with our everyday lives and practices. You'll have multiple ways to engage, and we welcome you to show up as your full self with all of your emotions and lived experiences. Please feel free to have your mic on or off, your camera on or off, and to participate in whatever ways feel the most comfortable for you. As far as our gathering flow, we're here in this moment of introductions and why we're gathering. We'll transition into a check-in. We'll have a significant amount of time with our grief, money, and power topic. There will be a break within that session, followed by a 10-minute break afterwards. We'll transition and come back into our practice-based conversation and close with announcements and farewells. Some access supports for us today. We have this slide deck that you will continue to have access to. You have editing access and it's interactive, so you can participate in the slide conversations and prompts. And also this recording, which will be shared as part of our follow-up email. For chat support, if you have any questions or concern, please give one of the facilitators time to respond via chat or audio. And if you would like to share in the chat, as far as a message, a response, or anything that you want to say, and you want your message to be read out loud by the facilitator, please put read before your message. And we have an example being shared of what that might look like in the chat. For ASL interpretation, we have two ASL interpreters with us for this event. Their names are Sue Owen and Terry Hayes. And you can pin them at any time on your screen. We have breaks this time. Sometimes we have breakout rooms. We're not doing that for this session, but we will have a break, a 5-minute and a 10-minute. We have live transcription that's been turned on via Zoom, and you can enable this at the bottom of your own screen. We have emotional support. Miro SK is back with us for this session, holding an emotional support role. They're here to hold space for a one-on-one connection. If something comes up for you and that space and support feels helpful, you can message to connect with them at any time privately via the chat, or via a separate breakout room if you would like that. And you'll hear more from Miro about what this emotional support role is holding. And again, show up as you are. Feel free to take additional breaks, have your camera on and off, move around your space, get comfortable, etc. What is the DJN Care Pod? Right now, we're defining ourselves as a soft, regenerative space for dreaming and designing liberatory cultures of care. Through these virtual gatherings and online, offline togetherness, We experiment with how the lineages of care and healing justice might shape the way we design more just community-led worlds. We're holding space as a team. Co-facilitation is held by me, Denise Chante, as well as Karina Fadell and Jody Chan. And emotional support. I'm gonna make some space for Mira to join us and speak to them.
Hello, everyone. Happy to be with you again. My name is Miro. My pronouns are they, them. For a visual description, I am a white-bodied, non-binary femme. Today, I am wearing a black ball cap, I think, again, and a black hoodie and a baby pink lacy floral house robe. With burgundy colored eyebrows and assorted earrings. And behind me is a window and a lamp. I am here today in recognition of all that our bodies carry, that they carry the marks of the oppressive systems we are gathering to upend, that connecting through our bodies when doing that can feel triggering, especially within community sometimes, and can bring up unexpected emotions, sensations, and memories. So if one-on-one chat and DMs or a breakout room is supportive of you at this time, please feel free to reach out. Happy to be here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mira. We have Victoria, who is joining us for tech support. Victoria is also one of our beloved DJN contractors and a previous steering committee member. If any tech issues arise, you can DM private message Victoria as well. And our guest practitioners, BIPOC Death and Grief Talk with Kayla and Carmen, they will be introduced more fully later, and we're grateful to have them as part of the series and part two of Grief, Money, and Power. For our grounding moment, I wanted to land in some context of this particular topic and share a little bit before we meet with our guest practitioners to co-design these gatherings. Our CarePod team spent some time to deepen into inquiries around why this particular topic, why grief, money, and power, and why this community. Dignity is one of the whys we named in that session. It also lives in the questions we're holding. Reflecting on these questions, I picked up the book Black Liturgies by Cole Arthur Riley. Maybe some of you all have this book or you follow Black Liturgies on Instagram. And Cole is bringing these really potent liberating expressions to Black interior worlds. And in her book, she has a section on dignity. What I've been holding as it relates to this topic and conversation and thinking about where we're at is that amid the presence of grief, money, and power and oppressive forces, our dignity and inherent worth is something that will never be diminished. There's possibility, there's beauty, there's creativity, and how we can envision new ways of resourcing our design and collective liberation work. So I'd like to bring Cole Arthur Riley into this space with us through the breathing practice she offers for dignity. This is an invitation, as all of our moments and prompts within this space, so please engage at the level of your interests and capacity. If you feel compelled to offer attention to your breath and slowly start to adjust to what feels possible in your body right now, I'll read the phrases to guide us inviting you to hold the phrase, the first phrase as you inhale, and hold the second phrase as you exhale. On the inhale, we honor this breath. On the exhale, we behold beauty. On the inhale, I deserve more. And on the exhale, I claim more. On the inhale, this flesh is sacred. And on the exhale, I contain the divine. Thank you for entering with us today. I'm grounding in this space, and I will transition to Jody.
Can I give a second for the ASL interpreters to switch over? Thank you. And thank you, Dinishante, for bringing Black liturgies and Cole Arthur Riley and that practice into the space. I'm really feeling it. And yeah. Sensing that others are feeling it too. So for checking in tonight, before we get into the main part of this session with Kayla and Carmen, which I'm really, really excited about, I wanted to come back to this design justice principle again. And this is the same principle that we connected this theme to in our first care circle. The ninth design justice principle, which says, what practices of care around money and grief have I already witnessed or known via my own lineages and communities? And also just realizing I didn't give a visual description of myself, so I'm going to do that now and then come back to this slide. I'm Jody. I'm a light-skinned East Asian person wearing a red hoodie and a black and white keffiyeh. Behind me in my background, there's a couple of plants, and I just noticed this very important stuffed giraffe that I love, and that brings me comfort. So coming back to this slide and this check-in, sometimes in our spaces, if you've been to a gathering before, we'll check in via a breakout room. But today we wanted just to offer some space to reflect on your own. So whether that's through, kind of being with yourself and whatever comes up in response to this prompt, if you want to write, to draw, to move, really in any way, in any capacity that feels good to you tonight, inviting you to reflect on this prompt again. What practices of care around money and grief have I already witnessed or known via my own lineages and communities? And connecting that with this design justice principle, principle number 9, we work towards non-exploitative solutions that reconnect us to the earth and to each other. So we'll do this for, 8 minutes or so. So that'll be around 26 minutes past the hour. Welcoming folks back slowly from that reflection space. Holding space for whatever came up in response to this prompt, including, as Miro brought up in the chat, the voids of care that might be there, and the ways that capitalism and colonialism and these systems isolate and alienate us and make it difficult to care for each other and for ourselves around money and grief. But we'll get a lot more into that in a moment. So on that note, I will pass it over to Denise Shante to introduce Kayla and Carmen, who are, gonna lead us in an amazing and deep conversation, continuing to connect these topics of grief and money and power and how it connects to our creative practices and design justice practices and all of that. So handing it over to you, Denise Shante.
Thank you so much, Jody. Grief, Money, and Power with Kayla and Carmen. I'm super grateful that we get to experience this for a second time and their facilitation and the guidance of this topic. Kayla Carter, she, her, they, them, is a full spectrum doula, artist, and grief educator. Carmen, she, her, is a death doula, grief educator, and social worker. Together, they created BIPOC Death and Grief Talks to respond to the need of racialized / global majority folks to talk about the complexities of racialized grief. I'm gonna hand it over to them as we get a fuller introduction and understanding of who they are in the space that they're holding.
Kayla, are you able to? There we go. Sorry about that. Hi, everyone. Perfect. Okay, cool. Hey, everyone. We're going to get into things. Like Denise Shante so graciously and wonderfully introduced us. My name is Kayla Carter. I use she, her, and they, them pronouns. The wonderful Carmen is here, there, but so that's why I'm pointing up like that. But Carmen will also introduce herself a bit more. But yes, we are BIPOC Death and Grief Talk. This will be the second time we will be sharing space with the wonderful folks of Design Justice Care Pod. And we are very, very happy to be sharing space with y'all. And as of course you all know, the topic for today, again, is going to be grief, money, and power. Because we did a care circle about a week or two ago. And just some of the themes that we brought up as we get into things, we'll touch on those things. But let's really get into things today. So as Denise Shante has mentioned, I am a full spectrum birth doula, which is work that I very, very much love. I'm also a multidisciplinary artist, and the core of my work is also within disability justice and doing a lot of consulting, but mostly facilitation work. And of course, starting the BIPOC Death and Grief Talk with the wonderful Carmen Galvan. I'm going to also let Carmen speak about herself a bit too.
Thank you, Kayla. You're amazing, and I love working with you too. So I am a disabled immigrant from Mexico, but I live on Treaty 13 in Toronto. And I do a lot of work around grief, death, and dying. I'm a grief counselor right now, but I also do a lot of work around labor and policy. And I like to do a lot of my death doula work as well, free of charge for racialized folks. And so that's who we are, I guess, as people.
Also, I think it might, I don't think I know it's important that we give like a visual description of ourselves. So I will start. I am a Black person. I'm a Black queer femme. I have brown skin, and right now I am wearing a beige knitted sort of pullover with a white tank top underneath. And then my hair is wrapped up in a red and yellow and blue head wrap, and behind me is a white wall and also white curtains as well.
And for myself, I am a light-skinned brown Latin American woman with long black hair, and I'm wearing a black top. And behind me are just a couple of pictures. And for anybody who doesn't know, my portrait is Selena Quintanilla, who I always have behind me, because I am Mexican and we love her. Yes, so that is me.
I knew that was Selena behind you. I always knew it. Okay, so we are going to get into our land acknowledgement. I'll give a bit of a preface for how we approach our land acknowledgements, and then Carmen will go through our land acknowledgement. So we're all on the same page. The link to the Native Land app, created by the wonderful Victor Gerard Tambrano, is a really very important, not just website, but also an app. It allows us to rethink how we understand geography and the land that we exist on. And I will say for me, as somebody who is a settler on Treaty 13 lands, specifically within Toronto, it is very, very important that I decolonize how I understand the land that I exist on. Also, with that being said, it's part of the practice of Carmen and I that we locate ourselves when we do land acknowledgements, especially once again as settlers on this land. So I am a first generation, with air quotes. That's a very loaded term, but I do think it's a very important term to understand that I am a settler on the land that has been named as Canada. My parents are Caribbean immigrants who both immigrated to Toronto in the early 80s. And the process of them being able to come here is a process of colonization. And they have also participated in that because they decided to come here. So I will say for myself, it's very important that I locate myself, not just because it's what we should be doing, but giving context for the colonial project, especially as we have conversations regarding grief and power and money, is very, very important. Yes.
Yeah, so I will also provide some context for myself before I read off the land acknowledgement. I, as I mentioned, am an immigrant. I came at a young age from Mexico. My mother is also Mexican, but we are settlers on this land for many reasons. When I think of Mexico, I often think of Canadian mining companies and the destruction that they've done to my home, and how that has forced many of us to move to this frozen tundra that we get very pale in. So it is what it is. And I would just like to say that part of the decolonizing work is also, when you go back home, taking that work with you, working around anti-Blackness, working around all the things that come up even in our own home communities, is extremely important, because those are all part of the colonial project to separate us. So these are all things that are very important to myself and my mother as well. So I'll start with the land acknowledgement. We acknowledge that the land we are meeting on is the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, and is now the home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. We acknowledge that Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit for the lands of east of Woodbine. Treaty 13 is signed by the Mississaugas of the Credit, and the Williams Treaty signed with multiple Mississauga and Chippewa bands. We would also acknowledge that as settlers on this land, as well as victims of colonization, dispossession, and genocide, we stand with all colonized and dispossessed people of the world, and it is our responsibility to support our folks suffering from state-sanctioned brutality and white supremacy around the globe. Thank you.
And then finally, with our land acknowledgements, we like to round them up with a, and then what? Oftentimes, I'm sure a lot of us have attended workshops or lectures or a bunch of different things or events where they do the land acknowledgement and that's sort of it. It's things that I would like, or I would encourage y'all to start thinking about after you complete either doing a land acknowledgement or receiving one or taking one in, is what does this mean? What does it mean for us to be doing this work on stolen land? Think about who was not in the room and just know that that is very deliberate 9 times out of 10. Okay. We have a collective responsibility to solidarity with the original caretakers of this land beyond words, but with actions. Yes, our words are very, very powerful and we need to be speaking truth to power. However, with that being said, we do need to be about actions. We do need to make sure that we are in alignment with the correct people. And then also that we are remaining teachable. It is very, very important, which brings us to our final one. We must be dedicated to unlearning and learning. As settlers, for a lot of us, we are filled up with a lot of ideas and unearned privileges as we exist on this land. And it's great to learn. However, unlearning provides more space for us to be filled up with not just a correct knowledge, but the most justified knowledge from the most correct people, and also knowledge from the land as well. So that's something that we wanted to round out our land acknowledgement with as well. Okay, so before we get into things, so this is sort of how things are going to be broken down. We're going to spend some time just going over some things surrounding grief. So just in case you weren't there for our first talk, we will just go over some myths that we have acknowledged, and we'll talk about those things surrounding grief. And then we'll also get into decolonizing grief. We'll get into a really wonderful conversation. If you've not been present for a conversation around policy and grief, given by Carmen, you're very, very lucky. It's very, very wonderful. And then we'll take a break, and then I will get into what does this mean? How do we unlearn things, and how do we reimagine how we understand grief, money, power, and ourselves? So just to start getting into things, a lot of us have very specific understandings of how grief is meant to be felt, what grief actually is, and if we're actually even experiencing it. And something that Carmen and I also really actually, wait, hold on, I want to stop before that. If you've never attended a workshop from BIPOC Death and Grief Talk, we want you to know that this is not a corporate retreat. You do not need to have your camera on. We will not be offended. If you need to eat at any point, please go ahead and get yourself a snack. If you need to start cooking at some point because you get real hungry, please do so. Also, let me know what you're cooking because I'm always hungry. And also, if today your participation looks like being on the couch wrapped up in a blanket and just staring into the screen, that's wonderful. That's 100% participation. And if today participation looks like ducking out maybe half an hour early because you've run out of spoons, 10 out of 10. We're really, really happy about that. Conversations around grief can be a lot. And it's really important to us that you all understand that the expectation is to participate on your own terms, not to prove anything to us. Okay, that's been said. So the thing that I want to say around how most of us understand grief is that if your understanding of grief is quite limited, if you actually don't have much of an understanding of grief, that's so understandable. And the reason why I say that is because so much of what we've learned about grief, what we've been taught about grief, actually does not work for most of us. So the first myth that we want to sort of pull apart is grief is the emotion you feel when someone dies. This is true, and that's why it's a myth. However, more than that, grief is about loss. Grief is about how our relationship to something changes and the loss of the relationship we previously had. So while grief is an emotion, is an experience that we feel when someone has died because of loss in how our relationship used to look to them, grief more specifically is actually so much more expansive than just being about death. Grief is about loss. And with that knowledge in mind, it actually opens up a lot wider of a framework for racialized folks, for Indigenous folks, for queer and trans folks, for poor folks to really insert ourselves into, oh, actually what I'm experiencing is grief and no one has passed on, yet here I am experiencing a lot of grief and it's not illegitimate. It actually makes a lot of sense.
I did want to mention, so when we talk about grief, grief isn't linear at all. Oftentimes we're told that it is. This is something that we mentioned in our last session, but it's not. We do not have a good cry and then frolic in the woods and everything is great. Things come and go. There are ebbs and flows, and sometimes it feels constant. So I don't want folks to feel like that's something that happens. And then also, grieving longer than 6 months means something is wrong with you is actually not true. That may be something that you hear from medical practitioners, but that's actually not the case. And we generally, grief practitioners, do believe that grief is something that you live with for the rest of your life as a griever. We always like to mention this five stages of grief, Kayla and I, because of course, that's one of the most pervasive myths that is out there. Everybody hears about the five stages of grief. But it actually turns out that it is not true at all. There can be way more than five emotions or five stages that come around. And the person who created the five stages of grief, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, made it very clear upon her own deathbed that she had made a mistake in creating the five stages of grief, as it was greatly misinterpreted by the general public. Because it was created to discuss some of the grief that her patients who were dying from cancer were experiencing, which is not necessarily the same thing. And not to mention that she worked mostly with men and mostly white men to do this kind of anecdotal research at one of the hospices that she worked. So we just like to make sure that we say that. And if you're not crying or experiencing sadness, you're not grieving. You can grieve without crying. You can grieve by laughing. You can grieve by doing. Some people become immersed in their work. Some people want to build things. Some people want to create something tangible out of their grief. And that doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with you if you don't cry. And we want to make sure that people know that there are various ways to grieve. Kayla, I don't know if you want to add anything to that last point.
Absolutely. And it's a great segue into our next point. I think one of the hardest parts of, let's just segue, decolonizing grief is really, really unlearning the same kind of process of unlearning that I was talking about in our land acknowledgement, a real active unlearning of not only how we have understood grief, but also how we understand grief in relationship to ourselves. So much of how grief is understood is from this very colonized understanding that likes to compartmentalize grief, put a time limit on grief, say that there's only five ways to do it. However, through a process of decolonizing grief, just to go back, sorry. We also realize that five stages is not expensive enough to hold the grief of all of us. Regardless of your identity, five stages of grief is not going to get it. Decolonizing grief also looks like understanding that we cannot shame ourselves or bully ourselves out of grief. This will be a topic that I get into a bit later, but it's really important to understand that when we are engaging in the practice of decolonizing grief, it's also really important to understand that, like, we will have pushback, whether it be from other people, whether it actually be from ourselves, around what grief is. And it's really important to know that A, grief is about a loss of connection and how we understand that. But grief is also not something you get over, it's something that you grow around. Oftentimes we feel as though, like, if I can just get over it, or I got through this step of feeling angry, so why am I angry again? Grief comes up all the time. Grief does not ask permission to show up, it arrives. And for a lot of us, we don't always realize that it's there. So yeah, that's some important context that we have. So the moment I personally really, really enjoy. Carmen is going to be talking to us about policy and grief, especially for y'all who are designers, who are arts workers, who are arts practitioners, in whatever capacity, there is a specific way that you all have an interest in design, and how, as creatives, do you design the world around you? Do you design programming? And how do you do that with care and intention? And it's very important to understand that that conversation also needs to be quite logistical. And understanding things like policy is not just something that we should be forcing ourselves to do. Understanding policy is also a form of liberation. So with, I'll throw it over to Carmen to really go through some things to really look out for when we're thinking about grief and policy.
Thanks, Kayla. For context, I haven't been recently, but I was a union steward at an agency that provided mental health support for workers. And I noticed that there was a lot of grief in my workplace, and I worked towards changing our collective agreement to add a bereavement leave policy that I felt fit our needs more. And through that, I also worked on my master's thesis, which was around grief and bereavement in the helping professions, and how do we tangibly create change towards more grief positive policies, because as much as I know that a lot of these policies and practices are steeped in white supremacy, this is what we're in at the moment. And so if there's anything we can do to change what we're dealing with at the moment, I think it's good to do that. And with policy, I am the biggest fan of loopholes and finding out where employers may have been a little more liberal with how they said things. And using that to our advantage. So with that, I'm going to be talking about bereavement leave policies and then colleague loss. So for our next slide, the first thing I would ask folks to do is to read your bereavement leave policy upon starting a new job, or even just now if you haven't seen it. The issue is that most times when we get those policy manuals of any kind, be it a collective agreement or just a regular policy manual, if you're not unionized, people aren't looking at the bereavement leave policy. They're generally looking at pay. They're looking at sick days and maybe vacation and maybe like internet use or something. That's about it. Those are really the main policies folks are looking at. Everything else is skimmed. What I would say is that a bereavement leave policy can give you a really great insight into how forward thinking the company is. And I say this because when we talk about decolonizing grief, a lot of the work that I did in my master's thesis was around how do these bereavement leave policies incorporate white supremacist ideologies? How do they incorporate ableism and this idea of the nuclear family? So if you have, for example, a bereavement leave policy that says you can get 5 days off if it's a parent or a child, and 3 days off if it's a grandparent or an aunt or uncle, and 2 days if it's a cousin, that bereavement leave policy is definitely based in white supremacy. And I would say that 99.9% are. Because what they're saying is, we get to dictate who gets to count as important to you. And for anybody who is queer or an immigrant, specifically a racialized person, we all have family that is not our biological family. And many of us, especially those of us who have moved from other countries, have chosen family and family that we have established in our country that has nothing to do with bloodlines. And so it's important to remember that this can be very painful if you work somewhere where an employer is asking for this information and you don't have anything to give. And that can be very difficult. So I just want to make sure that folks know that would be step number one. Look at your bereavement leave policy through the lens of how steeped in white supremacy is this, and go from there. And yeah, next slide. Totally fine. Thanks. Perfect. Pull it up on mine as well. Great. So analyze the underlying beliefs, as I mentioned. So does the employer ask for proof or paperwork to get time off? For many of us, we may experience a situation where if somebody, culturally speaking, or just in general, needs to be buried ASAP, and your employer is asking for paperwork. For example, for us in Ontario, it can take about 3 weeks sometimes to get that certificate that the person is deceased. And I have had situations where an employee has said, like, do I need to take a picture of the body to get time off? Like, what do we need to do? And so getting this information beforehand makes it a lot easier for you to plan and prepare. Because the issue is that if you look at it, once you've suffered a loss, you're also probably grieving and do not have the capacity to be dealing with these types of questions and these types of rules. And it can be very overwhelming while you're grieving. And then also think, does the employer take into account non-biological family ties? So that could even mean pets. There's a lot of folks whose pets are really important to them, and they wouldn't want to have to use all their sick time to be able to take time off, but they might have to because there's nothing in there for pets. There's nothing in there for friends, or even for some of us who may work in the helping profession. What if one of our clients dies? What policies are in place for us to make sure that we can take time off if that happens? What policies are in place if our colleague dies? How do we really support folks? And is there anything in there to support populations of people who are dealing with traumatic death after traumatic death? That's the other thing. If there are things going on, for example, when there were the protests around Black Lives Matter, the thought that Black folks were just supposed to come into work and act as normal, and there was no ability to take time off, and it was just kind of like a water cooler conversation, and people were just meant to just say, yeah, I'm having a really hard time with this, but anyway, let me get this work done for you, is bananas. I don't really know what to say about that, but that's definitely, like, there can be policy incorporated in that that can help us so that we can at least get like a day, a breather somewhere, just to help. Yeah. And next slide. So the other thing is that if the organization, this is where I say, if an employer says certain things, we absolutely use it to our advantage. If your employer or your organization has at any point stated wanting to be anti-oppressive, anti-racist, or has an equity, diversity, and inclusion mandate, because so many of them ran to get their EDI consultants in, we make sure that we use that to our advantage with bereavement leave policies. One of the things that you do is if there is an actual policy in there related to this, you can then come around and say, hey, you know, this is kind of my concern. You know, we have these EDI policies, but if you look at our bereavement leave policy, you get to tell me who counts and who matters. And then you have that conversation about white supremacy or how different things exist. And can we make this a little bit more flexible to reflect our mandated policies? The last slide in the chat requested to read out loud. So yes, so I can so read the whole thing, Mira?
Oh no, sorry. I was just pointing out that there was a question in the chat that says read regarding the third item.
So yeah. Sorry, I see that. Yes, so distance definitely traveling. Yes, it does. So the third item, so for folks, some of us may have family way back home. 3 days does not even get us home sometimes. So sometimes, and I have seen this in quite a few policies more recently, where they will say like 3 days, but an employer can grant you like an extension if it's further than X amount of kilometers. And that's another question around, will they pay those extra days or they're just going to like let you take them, which is another conversation. Because ideally they would pay you for those extra days. But if they factor in distance, I think that's very important because a lot of us have family out of town, out of province, but also on another continent and we need to get there. So that's also one of the pieces. Yes. Thank you so much, Miro, for seeing that question. I'm so sorry. So as we were talking about organizations and their policies, so you can bring forth like alternative wording for future policy changes. So what I like to tell people, and what I realized was a big thing when I did bargaining for collective agreement things, was that if the more work you do upfront, the more likely it will get passed by the employer. Because the less work the employer has to do, the happier they are, which is terrible because that's a lot of emotional labor and a lot of time and a lot of effort that we have to put into getting something semi-okay into a policy. But if you bring forth like alternative wording, for example, and you can just say, hey, you know, I've seen, you know, policies like this in other workplaces, just wondering if this is something we can incorporate. And then you just send the wording. And then that way, if they want to, they just copy and paste, stick it in. Everything's great. And sometimes that does work. At my last workplace, we didn't have any policies. We were like a startup nonprofit organization. And I sent them word for word part of my thesis around how to write a anti-oppressive bereavement leave policy. And I just sent them that. And they did freak out a bit because it does say 10 days off and they lost their whole minds, but it's okay. They did end up completely changing what their HR specialist had made because their HR specialist had made exactly the horrific type of policy you get where it's like your mom gets 5 days, your cousin gets 2 days, blah, blah, blah. And so they did change that. And we were an organization that was almost all queer and racialized. So that was also one of the things that was very interesting. And so being able to go in and say, hey, we just had equity and diversity training yesterday. You're showing us this bereavement policy today. Do you not see the problem here? And then I sent them the stuff and then it worked. Now, it all depends on the type of workplace you're at. We don't want anyone to get fired. I generally say like collectively, it's good to have these policies and explain to people. There's a lot of research related to people being forced to go back to work before they're ready or not being given enough time other than just to go to a funeral and how that can really impact a person's ability to work well. So obviously, capitalism, it all comes back to production. And it's unfortunate, but sometimes we do have to say, if you know, it costs more to train someone and hire someone. Wouldn't it be better for our workers to have a better mental health related bereavement leave policy that can prevent burnout and can prevent the chronic illnesses and things that come up with people going back to work when there's a lot of grief? And there is a lot of peer-reviewed academic research related to that, where people end up just failing miserably at work, which of course we would. We're not supposed to be working. So that doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with you. So I did want to mention that. And so collectively, please make sure that if this is something scary for you, if you do it collectively, you bring it up as a question. I think it's really important. If you just ask questions, people feel less, employers sometimes get less defensive, where you're just like, hey, I just have a question about this policy. What if I don't have like one spouse? Or like, what if my partner dies and I'm not legally married? You know, just like ask questions so that they percolate on it, think about it. So it's a little bit easier to kind of do that. I just saw a question. Would you bargain for employers to include a budget for colleague support, or is the purpose of the slide to demonstrate how workers can show up for one another, or both? So I would want, so that's definitely something you can do. Employers should, I think, have a budget for colleague support, but I also think collectively we can do that as well, which I am going to talk about, which is the wellness fund. I think that's really important, but both. I think both are important. The employer should be able to have some sort of an emergency fund if needed. For example, at my agency, not related to grief, but because we did a lot of going into people's houses, there was a little bit of money aside if anybody ever ended up with bed bugs. So things like that, very little, but you know, whatever that might look like. And so, yes, but also we'll talk about collectively how you can do this. So in terms of supporting workers, Kayla, do we take a break after this? Yes. Okay. So in terms of supporting each other and workers, I think one of the main things is oftentimes when someone passes away, we do get things like flowers and cards. I think that's nice, but I don't necessarily think it's always the most practical thing to give. And one of the things Kayla and I always say is that people need help when they're grieving with the business of being human. They just need support in the basic needs. They don't necessarily always need flowers and cards, because they may have a lot left over from funeral service. So it may just be like a room full of flowers, which sometimes is nice, sometimes not. But they may need other more practical things. So for example, Kayla and I always suggest providing gift cards for food delivery services instead of, or with flowers and cards. That way, when someone is actually not able to cook for themselves, they'll have something there so they can eat. Offering childcare support for parents and guardians who are grieving is super important. That's something that you can do either like folks offering their own time, or also there are services available or providing money so that they can have their babysitter come in or something like that. Super helpful. That also goes for the offering cleaning services. Sometimes when you're grieving, all you want to do is clean. And sometimes you don't want to clean at all because you can't get out of bed. And so offering cleaning services is also another option. Creating the food trains, in quotations, for when coworkers go through hardships. So people having a set list of like who comes in on what days to deliver food. And you do this for a week or two, just so that the person at least has a meal a day that they don't have to make for themselves or for their family, is something really great. And a lot of communities do these things. I think culturally, a lot of us, when someone dies, we have food brought to us. But for those of us who may be isolated or may not have as much community support or family support, having this in the workplace can be really healing and can really help you focus on the grief itself, which is what's necessary. And then again, as I mentioned, creating the wellness fund for caregivers who may need respite care. And so that can look like all sorts of ways. I've seen situations where people sign off on providing, like when they get the job, they sign off on giving $2 of their paycheck, of every paycheck into this fund. And if somebody has been through, it doesn't even necessarily need to be a death. If somebody's going through medically a hard time or is a caregiver for someone going through a hard time, they can then access some of those funds and be able to get things like massages or get a PSW or somebody to come in to provide that support so that they can have a day to rest. These are things that we can do for ourselves. And hopefully it doesn't cost too much. I would generally say, I think I've seen it where it's like $2. So it's not much, but it does add up with all the employees, obviously, every 2 weeks or whenever you get paid, having that fund there, and just making sure that, you know, the employer is going to ask for all sorts of things, obviously, when we have these funds. So keeping that in mind, that they'll be like, where are the receipts or whatever proof you need, that will be in there because it is a workplace and paperwork is a thing that they always ask for, unfortunately. But I definitely think that it's something that's doable and helpful, hopefully, and people can always opt out. If folks don't feel comfortable doing that, there's always that option of they don't have to, it's not a requirement. And so only the people who feel that it's useful can use it and provide money into it. Yeah.
Carmen, sorry, there's another slide. There's another slide.
Oh yeah. Don't worry about it. All good. My brain is just also not working right now. So in terms of financial accessibility in the workplace, so this is not always something that we think about. Sometimes it just passes our mind. We're too busy working. We're just trying to get things done. But we do have some options for folks. So for example, some employers, have, and I generally find that it's employers who they themselves have had, like have not grown up with money, which is just anecdotally what I have noticed, but employers can offer financial planners for free because they cost money, and or can cost money. And also the emotional labor and just labor in general of having to find a financial planner can be overwhelming and boring and difficult. And so employers can offer financial planners in order to help learn about things like retirement savings plans, investments. And for some people, and things like investments feel really icky, especially for those of us who didn't grow up with money. It just sounds very like Scrooge McDuck, but it's not. You know, there are ways in which we can kind of hopefully have some sort of savings if we have enough money to do that. But having a financial planner, in my opinion, can help even the playing field in terms of the lessons that we learn as working class people versus the lessons that folks with money learn from birth, because we don't have the same knowledge and we don't have that same information. And so having somebody who can really provide that support to you is great, even just for knowledge, just to have. And if your employer, if that's something your employer could provide, I think that would be great. That's always something you can ask for. And it's a great thing to just have on hand, even just to ask them questions. And then employers can also offer to provide some level of retirement savings support if possible. So I always say like matching a certain amount that you put in, or providing amounts based on surplus and funding is something I've also seen. Again, it depends where you work. It depends how things happen. But generally speaking, employers can be open to hearing it. Now, will they do anything with this information? Maybe not. But I always say it's good to ask because it does allow for employee retention, which is what you tell them when they ask you, what is the point of this? You tell them it helps retain your employees, and then you don't have to train people and hire people because that's very expensive to do. So if you bring it back to their money, unfortunately, because that's the world we live in, that's how that works. So avoid things like work outings that need to be paid for by staff. If your employer is sending you out to outings and not paying for them, red flag. No, let's not do that. I would also, unless it's, I mean, if it's a situation where you can say no, and there won't be any consequences to you in the future, maybe. But I generally think that that's a big no-no. So ensuring that if that happens, to say, hey, like, are you covering this? Just want to know what's happening here. Or ensuring that lunch outings are held in spaces that are accessible. So both physically, obviously, but also financially. So going to like a food court where people can bring their own food and don't necessarily have to buy food might be something that makes things more accessible. People aren't always going to want to talk about their financial instability with their colleagues. It might feel really scary. And they might feel, because there's so much stigma around poverty, they might not want to say anything. So if you invite folks out for for outings with colleagues, and they can't pay, they may not want to tell you that. And so this gives people the option of bringing their own food, or getting something cheaper, as opposed to going to a restaurant where you have to get something, and people may feel really awkward and not want to go out, and things like that. So that might make it a little bit more comfortable. Supporting workers with things like insurance planning where possible. This is where me as a death doula, I come in. We don't learn about things like life insurance. If we could afford it, great, but we can't. And some of us can't, but there are accessible ways sometimes to get life insurance, or sometimes workplaces can have life insurance in place for you. So looking into what that looks like, looking at your policy, do I have that in place? And I bring this up as a death doula because this comes up a lot when folks are asking about how do I set up my affairs? And so that's something that your employer can definitely help with as well. Asking for more wellness funding, as I mentioned, from your employer, allowing for work from home or hybrid wherever possible. I know it's not possible for everyone, but wherever, because it saves you money on transportation. And gas prices are wild. So as well as just public transportation is so expensive right now. And then allowing for flex hours where possible. If we can allow for people to have flex hours, they may be able to not need to worry about childcare a couple of days a week, or they might not need to worry necessarily about having a PSW come in at certain days of the week for, you know, their parents or anything like that. It could also mean that for them, it may, just accessibility wise, it may be easier for them to work later in the evening if that's when they can focus. And then that means that their work will be better quality if you don't force everyone to work 9 to 5 or 8 to 4, which is an arbitrary time to just force everyone to work when we could, some of us like myself, work better from like 8 p.m. to like 2 a.m. for some reason. And that's how that works. And allowing for that to happen can be really helpful just in general, I find, for accessibility. That's not necessarily grief related, but I always like to add that to the piece in terms of making things financially accessible. So yes, do folks have questions?
No. We are going to take a 5-minute break. So if folks have questions after the break, that is totally fine as well. So let's come back together at 7:20, and then we'll get into the other portion, but also we'll have time just in case anyone has questions. Hi, everybody. So we're back. Let's take a couple of minutes, just in case anyone had any questions. We will also have a Q&A portion at the end today, but I did want to check in about that.
Also, I did want to say Kayla and I do grief education workshops for organizations. And that is sometimes a sneaky way for us to come in and say, what do your bereavement policies look like? How can we support you in that without anybody getting in trouble? So if ever that's something that you're folks are looking for, send us an email. We'll have our contact information there. It's a sneaky way for us to kind of come in as quote unquote experts and talk about how to change the policies with the employers without it having to be the staff kind of possibly risking the wrath of an employer on the front end. So if that's something you folks need, let me know.
So let me just check the chat. Okay, that's all good. So yes, as Carmen mentioned, we are very, very good at navigating corporate spaces and also not-for-profit spaces. That could be a whole other workshop. But it is very important to have accomplices in those spaces. And Carmen and I are glad to be accomplices to help navigate those spaces. So the next portion is going to be, I'm going to talk about some key frameworks and topics that not only came out of the care circle, but really help us imagine and like get rooted in what that sort of transformation looks like. So checking our internal beliefs and judgment about money. It's really important for us to really be interrogating and unpacking what our internal beliefs are, because our internal beliefs are essentially what we think that we deserve and what we assume will happen and what we are open to receiving. So checking our internal beliefs around money is incredibly important, because upon checking and really sitting with our internal beliefs and judgment around money, we also get to the root of it, which is grief. Most of us have never been called to grieve our relationship with money, let alone unpack how we arrived at our own understandings of money. So it's really about what are the things that I believe about money, and did I put that there? So that's something that's really, really, really important to really implement when we're starting this. The other thing that I will say around checking our internal beliefs and judgment around money is that a lot of our internal beliefs and judgment around money has been put there from somebody who also did not unpack their internal beliefs and judgment around money. And that transference, unfortunately, demonstrates a level of like not only intergenerational, but also intercommunity trauma that can take place around money. That is a huge, huge thing. A lot of us have money wounds, and not in this way of like, you need to heal your money wounds, so stop spending money on the one thing that you can find that can bring you some joy at Dollar Tree. That is not what we're saying here. What we're actually saying is, how are we attending to our money wounds, but making sure that we're not using the same tools that created the wound in the first place? So we live in a society that is very much pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You need to show everybody how hard you're working. And if you're not showing people how hard you're working, are you actually working? And that is really harmful for us, because that starts maybe with work, it starts in school, and then it starts to get into everything else around us. So much so that you're like, I don't know where to begin. It's really, really important that as we begin this process of checking our internal beliefs and the judgment that we have for ourselves, that we're doing this gently. A lot of the time, we can feel that the only way for transformation and reimagining a relationship, whether that be with money or with ourselves, we oftentimes feel like that needs to be one that's about brute force. However, I'm very excited to let you all know that the way that we arrived And the way that we came in to the hardest parts of ourselves, some of our wounds, that is not going to be the way that we heal them. And that is also not going to be the way that we unpack them. Being gentle is not just about being lenient. It's actually about how do I approach myself and others in the community that is around me with compassion. So from there, it's also about reframing our relationship with money, worth, and dignity. So dignity is something that's been brought up throughout our time together today. And the reason why I say that I want us to think about reframing over completely overhauling, it's because I don't want to ever assume that the ways in which you've had to navigate money, the things that you learned about money, that all of it is inherently wrong. We don't need to do this very colonizing thing of completely sweeping everything away and thinking that if we start with something completely new, that we are self-righteous and we're good for it. Actually, we have so much brilliance. We have so much knowledge. And reframing it is actually about how can I take the brilliance and knowledge that I already have and use that even more and deeply and gently to not only my benefit, but subsequently to my community and to the land that I exist on. So reframing is not about how do we shame ourselves into transforming our relationship with money. Reframing is saying, I'm literally doing the best that I can with what I've got. I know some of us have seen that wonderful video of Mariah Carey inevitably at a cipher in the late 90s saying that she's going to do the best she can with what she's got. And that's what most of us have done. Something that Carmen and I reference quite often is the brilliance of surviving and navigating capitalism. When you are experiencing poverty, and you do not have the money to meet all of your needs, and you do not have the financial means to be able to live a life on your own term, having to be a certain level of brilliant in order to know, who can I pay first? What can wait? When am I getting paid? Will I have enough money to clear everything off? And am I going to have to take money from somewhere else so that I can pay my rent, knowing that in 2 weeks, I'm going to take that back as well? Though this is exhausting and I'm never going to romanticize it, I do think it's a level of brilliance. And I'm saying this because I've been around a lot of, unfortunately, I've had to be around a lot of very affluent and well-established people. And for them, explaining what a month financially looks like for me blew their minds. The concept of having to wait to pay a certain bill so that you can get groceries and being like, I could be a bit late on this bill, but I actually need to eat today. That is a level of brilliance that we have, unfortunately, a lot of us have earned. And especially when I think about the fact that this is about design. How have we had to redesign the world around us, reframe the world around us so that we can exist in it? I have a very strong personal belief that if you experience some level of oppression, you are a wonderful designer. You are constantly having to renegotiate the world around you. You are constantly having to redesign your own expectations. And you're constantly having to redesign a world that was created not only with you not in mind, but actively against you. Once again, the labor of having to navigate this, all of this, is not something that should be taken lightly. It's a level of brilliance that unfortunately a lot of us have earned. So when I say that we need to reframe our relationship, once again, it's not about assuming that everything that we've done before is incredibly bad and that all of our tools to navigate all of this, it was just terrible. We're literally doing the best with what we've got. Gentleness as a practice for liberation and transformation. I mentioned this a bit before, but oftentimes we can feel as though transformation is for ourselves personally is only going to come through a route of being incredibly barbaric, very unkind, very mean, and essentially using the same tool of communication, the same tool of engagement that actually harmed a lot of us into the beliefs that we have right now about not only money, but also our worth and our dignity. Gentleness is a process by which we get to be firmly compassionate with ourselves and unrelenting with it. A lot of us feel and have been sold this idea that gentleness is very like, woo-woo, it's going to be okay, and I'm going to handle you with kid gloves. I would actually push to say that gentleness is firmly saying, actually, you are doing the best with what you can, with what you've got. And also, I know that you are worthy of so much more, so why don't we put something to that? That's what gentleness for me is. Gentleness is also saying that I actually can rethink how I understand money, and I can grieve my history of money while also being kind to myself. We can acknowledge the debt that we're in while also saying, yeah, this thousands of dollars that I'm having to navigate right now, I did the best that I could when I literally had nothing. It's wild how we have a practice of compassion for everyone else but ourselves, when in all actuality, your practice of gentleness and compassion is exponentially grown when we have the practice of doing it with ourselves. And I think it's really, really important that we understand that we can do these things, and we can reframe how we understand money, not only for ourselves, but for our communities, while also understanding how hard it has been, and let's be honest, how hard it will continue to be for a lot of us as well. And then specifically when I think about the practice, my use of the word practice, I use that because I never want us to feel as though that there is a quick way to go about these things. It's very important that I'm honest about this, and reframing and rethinking how we understand money is painful. It is a very, very hard, hard process, and that's why it is about grief. Having to do the work to A, just sit with your own grief, we could just call it there. It's extremely, extremely painful. It is physical as well. It's another myth that we both love to completely rip open. Grief is not this thing that's purely cerebral. And even though I feel so many ways about this word, it is a deeply embodied experience. This is a very, very correct usage of this word. Grief is a deeply embodied experience. You are physically going through it. A lot of us do not always understand that sense of tiredness that we feel that is completely unprovoked, that sadness that we feel that's completely unprovoked, that loss of appetite or that increase in appetite that we think is just like, where is this coming from? It's usually grief that's festering and that we don't even realize that it's there. Why? Because most of us do not have an education in grief. Once again, that is so okay. We're all learning how to figure out what to do with the grief that we have and how to unlearn what we thought we knew about grief as well. Okay. And then the underlying pressure surrounding money. So this is something that's really important to talk about. And we alluded a bit to it in the care circle a couple of weeks ago. However, I do think it's important to really state that there is an unbelievable pressure around money. And this pressure around money impacts not just us, but also the programs that we may be leading, the programs that we may be facilitating, the co-design projects that we're working on, our personal projects as creatives, as arts practitioners, as arts workers. That pressure around, am I going to get the funding in time? I have to write the grant. I have to prove to these people who want artists to create art that you are in fact going to make the art, and this is how much it's going to cost. The fact that granting processes are essentially created as an interrogation process to set you up to constantly have to prove that you are not a fraud, that you're not taking these people's money, despite how weird they got the money is, essentially, it puts us as artists, as creatives, as people who are working in community spaces, as constantly having to preemptively say, I'm not messing up with this money, and I'm not just going to take it and dip off. The fact that that's the sort of our introduction into funding, into grants, into handling money, that sets us up for a really, really unfortunate pressure that will never, ever end. I'll say it myself as somebody who's had to handle grant money. I hate it. I absolutely hate it, because as if it wasn't bad enough to write the grant, you then have to do the report after it. And reports, as if grants weren't bad enough, reports are set up to be like, you better come here and prove yourself, and don't you leave one thing behind. And unfortunately, that is what happens for a lot of us. Also, the grant process, the reporting process, so many of the financial portions and neighborhoods of what goes into the lives of so many of us reflects the stories, the judgment, and the beliefs that we had in the first place around money. So then we end up in these spaces where our beliefs around money that do not benefit us, that do not work in alignment with us, are not only reinforced, but then are once again connected to our livelihood. And the reason why I give this genealogy is really to affirm that if you really despise having to engage with money, I overstand. I completely understand it, because so many corners of how we have to engage with money is really about us constantly having to prove our worth, constantly asking for the dignity to be able to do what we know we are good at, what we have proven that we are good at, and what we know that we can do for our communities. It's an extremely, extremely, not just, it's not just about the pressure, it's about the fact that it can be an extremely triggering process. And I really want to affirm that for us. It should not just be part and parcel with what happens with doing grants. A grant process should not trigger us and should not affect our mental health. However, that is what happens. And speaking about that pressure is also how we really, really address that it's not okay. So if no one's told you that, I hope you know that it's not okay to feel that way when you are navigating money, not just within your personal life, but within your lives as creatives, as arts practitioners, as arts workers, as co-designers, but also people who are working in community. It is an unbelievable amount of pressure to deal with as well. Another side of the pressure that I wanted to speak to was also the ways in which we live in a society, especially with social media, where we are constantly seeing purchases that other people are making. And though it seems like a very, very small thing, it adds up. And when we are constantly being inundated with not just other people's purchases, but how they are spending their money without an understanding of how they arrived at that money, what that money actually means for them, we then unfortunately start, and however, though it's unfortunate, it's also very understandable, we inevitably start to take on this pressure of, I'm not doing this thing, or I can't afford to do this thing. I can't afford to pay for this thing. I can't afford to do a lot of these things. And I want you all to know that that pressure is so, so real. It's not about, it's not just about, well, you're being jealous, or, and it's also definitely not about, you have unrealistic expectations. It is very, very, very understandable in our society where we are constantly being inundated with not only the pressure to commodify everything that we do, but also the pressure to just buy and overconsume everything around us. And then that turns into a judgment, which is then connected to how a lot of us were judged around our own money beliefs and our own money stories and our own experiences around money. And the reason why I use these two seemingly very like polar opposite examples is because a lot of the pressure that we have surrounding money is deeply connected to the introduction of our stories around money. And that's why making sure that we are checking what our beliefs are with gentleness. We're checking our judgments with gentleness. really makes it so that when we do grow up and we start getting into spaces where we are experiencing that pressure, we could clock that pressure as like a, and that voice inside of us that says, you can't afford that, or you should be able to afford that, is like, hey, that's actually not even me. And then B, also, that's some like colonizer in my head that's making me feel bad for existing. And I think it's very, very important daily, drag the colonizer in your head. If nothing else, make them feel terrible, because they started it and you get to finish it. Knowing how to handle money is learned, not intuitive. I need y'all to remember this, and I'm saying this, and the y'all is me too. Knowing how to handle money is not, is knowing how to handle money is learned, not intuitive. Carmen mentioned this earlier, that knowing how to navigate policies, knowing how to navigate with money is not something that we just like know how to do. This is learned, gathered information that unfortunately is beholden to people with a lot of class privilege or who have a lot of proximity to people with class privilege. And the reason why I say this is because, once again, that pressure around how much are we buying? I can't afford this thing. And how to deal with all of that and that lack of access to the money and financial means that you need. It's not just about being bad with money. I'm also going to push to say that in order, under capitalism, in order to be bad with money, you need to be making a very specific amount in order to be doing that. What I wish more people understood is that you are doing the best that you can under a very violent system that makes you pay for food, water, and a roof over your head. That is violent, and that is not okay ever. We live in a society where people feel a superiority complex because they cover all of their bills on their own and don't receive any support. And that also points to things like hyper-individualism. And we live in a society where you will get praised for that, right? And I use these examples because I really want us to know that, like, for a lot of us, we've been trying to pivot around money for our entire lives. And I want you to know, if you are exhausted and you're like, oh, actually, the debts are going to be debts and the bills are going to be bills and I'm done and I don't have anything left in me to give, I completely get it, because for a lot of us, our grief around money is actually some of the longest grief that we've been processing and that we've been experiencing. So I think that's also really, I don't think, I know that's also really, really important to state. Also, when I mentioned that knowing how to handle money is learned, not intuitive, I'll give a prime example about this. My understanding and the genealogy of like how to navigate money, still can't do it because I don't have that level of money, started at the University of Toronto, which is a colonizing imperialist billion-dollar pseudo-educational facility. And I will say that over and over again. However, going to a school that is that affluent means you will sit in class beside people who don't have a clue what Dollarama is. And because of that, they also don't have a clue about how to handle money when you don't have a lot of it. However, what they do have are very, very rich parents who will sit down and tell them just about everything. So specifically, there was in my second year of my undergrad, I had a conversation in a political science course, because of course, where else would I have a conversation with somebody that is that affluent, being a equity studies and gender studies major. However, during that conversation with them, I was talking to them about getting OSAP, which in Ontario, where I'm currently located, that's considered student loans. First of all, this person did not know what student loans were. So purely off the strength of that, I was like, we're living in two different worlds, baby. I don't know what to tell you right now. And then subsequently, this person had the nerve to say to me, well, maybe if you just like got some of the money that you do have and you put it in a high interest savings account, You could grow it by the time you're done and pay off your student loans. Now, I need you all to know that Kayla Carter back then was a fresh 20 years old and had nothing but mouth for everybody, and also was freshly into equity studies. So I was just spewing whatever I learned. And having to explain to this person that being able to have the money, the disposable income to put in a high yield savings account means that you have some money to play with. I don't got money to play with. And a lot of us do not have money to play with. We can play with a lot of things, but not the money. And they use that example to say that, like, the reason why this person learned this, they're in a political science class, they're not learning about finances like that. They had parents that would just put them on every step of the way because they had access to that, and because that knowledge had been passed on and on and on. Knowing how to handle money, and that's why what Carmen mentioned about having employers who will pay and subsidize for you to sit with a financial advisor is really, really wonderful, because it allows you to gain knowledge in spaces and of money that you otherwise would not know. And that, in conjunction with the brilliance that unfortunately a lot of us have had to learn, allows us to actually be extremely brilliant and very capable when it comes to handling money. Yes, I just wanted to mention that. Okay, so actually before we get to, oh, how do we jump that far? Okay, that's better, thank you. So I wanted to round out this session by saying, we come from communities, we come from communities of care. We come from histories of care. I think, especially as I reference hyper-individualism, it is very, very easy in our society to forget not only the histories of who we come from, but what they've experienced. Because of that, we also forget that we have a deep history in our bodies of being capable and supporting each other. And the reason why I say that, as Carmen mentioned before, when she was talking about colleague care and work and how do we show up for our colleagues, I really want us to remember that we are very, very good at showing up for each other, because more than anybody else, we know how hard this is. And this is something that I state all the time. I would much rather have support from members of my community than from the state. I trust members of my community to listen to me and not incarcerate me because my mental health is not doing well. I trust members of my community to understand how to show up for me around money without shaming me. And the reason why I state, and I really want to push the fact that we do come from communities of care, is because we would not be here without our communities and histories of care. It is because of the very deliberate communities of care that I've been able to exist here and make it through my 20s, through my childhood. It's because of histories and communities of care that I've been taught how to navigate money, how to be able to support people, but also it's through histories and communities of care that I've been able to completely reimagine how we can understand money in ways that do not constantly ask us to prove our self-worth and our dignity, but actually not force us, but engage us in a conversation of how can we understand money in ways that are positioning and centering our worth and our dignity, while also making sure that we are being held accountable. Our communities are the places where we can be held accountable gently, but being held accountable, being called in, and also being supported around how we engage with money is really important. It's very important for me to say that navigating money, especially after you've had it, can feel really, really hard. Navigating money after you haven't had it and then you get it can feel really, really hard. Our first go-to usually is like, Who do I need to take care of? What do I need to take care of? And how do I do that as quickly as possible? And that's once again going back to the fact that I don't want us all to sweep away all of our ways and our practices of engaging with money, because being generous with our community, wanting to take care of our community is really important. However, making sure that we are positioning our worth and our dignity is really, really important as well. And making sure that we have support in that. We do not need to have all of the answers. We get to be able to be supported in dignity and having our self-worth intact in how to navigate new amounts of money. We get to have really important conversations, despite how uncomfortable they may be, about the pressure we feel about money. And also we get to be really honest about the fact that we don't like a lot of the processes about around money, and the positions that they put us in. So I wanted to end off with that. And also some room for some question and answers as well. I've not checked the chat, so I'm going to do that right now. But yeah.
Well, I don't think there are any questions in the chat. But I think we have a break after this. So maybe if folks do have questions, we can put them, like they folks can put them in the chat and we can come back to them. Mayhaps. Okay.
That sounds great. Sorry.
Well, thank you both so much. My name is Karina. I will give a quick visual description of myself before sending folks on break. And gentle reminder that the space for questions or anything that's arising is going to be in the chat while we're on. So I am a white femme with a bald head and some tortoiseshell glasses and some big headphones that look like earmuffs. I'm wearing a blue static looking turtleneck dress with a blurred background. And all of me is very, very grateful for tonight. So this is where I send you all on breaks and we'll come back at 8 p.m. back here. So thank you all so much. Take some time, use the bathroom, get whatever you need, and we'll see you back at 8 p.m. Eastern. Welcome back from break, everybody. I'm gonna give folks a moment to land and arrive back with us all. You can look into the chat for the slides that we're going to be on. And I hope folks were able to nourish and tend to themselves while we had this time. Going to be entering the practice space conversation. This is the moment where we begin to make connections between the conversation and all of the listening that we just did with Kayla and Carmen, and apply that to what we're doing and the design justice principles, and also just how we're moving forward with this work in our lives. So we're going to be having another bit of space for personal reflection. We're going to be inviting you to reflect on a few different responses that will be up on the screen in just a moment. While we do that, there will be some music playing, and we invite you to really lean into whatever type of reflection or form of reflection best fits you right now. If that's writing, collaging, we have space for that. We also are asking, if possible, for you to make some space to also share those reflections in the digital form on slides 36 to 39. Those will be those slides and that those spaces to add in will be on slides 36 and 39. And right now in the chat, we've dropped in the link for the slide with the page 34. So you just go a bit further from that to add in your own reflection. We're going to be exploring the following two questions. How could this practice begin to transform your ways of collaborating with the communities you're accountable to? What ideas and systems can the learning from tonight and last week, or the care circle, what ideas and systems can all of this shift? The other question we'd like to offer is, what would it look like to be in an ongoing relationship with and commitment to this practice? We've had such a rich, rich time together, filled with so much. And this is also a reminder that this is a recorded session and you can come back, revisit, and really use this as a tool in your life. And so what would it look like to be in an ongoing relationship with and commitment to this practice and this learning that we've been in? We're going to have some time after this personal reflection space to come back and share. And we'll be doing that after about 10 minutes on our own to both reflect in the ways that feel best and share on those slides 36 to 39. Thank you all so much. We're going to be dropping in the chat the direct link for the slides 36 to 39 to share with. And that will be the space that you can share publicly in a co-design sort of collaborative way so that we can see how everyone is kind of thinking and reflecting on these inquiries. Thank you so much. And we'll be back in 10 minutes, which is about 8:14 Eastern. welcoming us all back. And up on the screen, we'll be having some time with slides 36 through 39. And we'll also have just a few minutes here to share in the chat some ways that, you know, you've reflected and what came up for you. So just a reminder in terms of the chat, please add read in front of your message so that we can know to read that out loud. And we'll just be taking some time to move through slides 36 through 39. If the link to that can be dropped in the chat for some ease in case folks didn't get there yet. A reminder that you can move through this again asynchronistically after tonight's meeting ends. And also, this is a time where you can just take a second and just kind of look over what all has been added to this space while we had that time for our personal reflection. We have some verbal and nonverbal shares, which is always great, some images. If anyone would like to share anything collectively, you can do so in the chat. And no pressure at all to do that. Also inviting folks to give yourself some space and time to return here. Tonight has been such a full experience with so much wisdom that was shared. Wanting to invite folks to come back to these slide spaces and add in later, maybe when something has integrated or arisen in you, you know, beyond the time. Thank you all so, so much for all the ways that you've been giving your reflection space in the collective and for all the reflecting you've been doing in ways that we haven't seen or heard of tonight. All of that's been really beautiful. And I'm going to pass along to Jody to close us out. Thank you.
Yeah, I am back to close with some announcements and reminders and goodbyes. Before I do that, just want to say another big, big, big thank you to Kayla and Carmen for tonight and for the Care Circle session as well. I'm still sitting with and feeling really moved by this last point in your slides about community care and lineages, and just this reminder that our survival is in and of itself evidence of that care. Just finding that really beautiful. And I think Kayla, you had mentioned how so many of us don't get to have an education in grief and an education in money and in surviving without shame. And so I just want to thank both of you for giving us such a comprehensive education in all of that, and one that's so rooted in collective care and in collective liberation. Yeah, thank you. So as we close, another reminder that we have one more Care Pod gathering theme coming up in July, and that'll be on inner and outer ecologies, and we'll share more about what that all means as we get closer to that date and as we announce the guest practitioner that we'll be working with for those gatherings too. So stay tuned for that. That'll be in our newsletter. So If you're signed up to the Design Justice Network newsletter, you'll get all the announcements for that, and it'll be on our social media as well. And we'll also be sending out a follow-up email after today that shares links, resources, a really great handout that Kayla and Carmen have created that talks about, yeah, some of these ideas around grief and power and money that we've been discussing today. So you'll also get that. And folks who are participating asynchronously, hello, you'll be getting all of that as well. Another reminder that you can stay connected to us through our arena. And this is a place where we archive our work, our lineages of the DJN Care Pod, and also all of the tools and resources that come out of these sessions. And one thing in particular that we wanted to highlight that's on our arena is actually a digital care package on grief that we created, including contributions from other folks in the DJN ecosystem. So the Care Pod, Miro has a great playlist that is included in that care package, and yeah, and other offerings that you can read, watch, listen to, practice with, and connect with surrounding grief. And originally, we had created this last year to hold us through the winter pause and beyond. But yeah, coming out of these last two sessions on grief, and also in these times of grief, thinking about Palestine and Sudan and the Congo and other peoples and places and oppressed peoples impacted by genocide around the world. So we're returning to this offering and thinking of it, and wanted to remind you that it's there. And one more offering. I won't get us to do this now because it's been already a very full, very reflective time that we've had together, but we have this Collective Care Maybe document, which is a place that we've been recording some of our expressions and possibilities of care that have come up throughout all of these gatherings from last year to now. So yeah, I definitely invite you to open up that document when you have a second, and if you have the space to do it, and to add your own definitions and your own possibilities of what care may be. And it's something that we bring back to every gathering and that we return to. So yeah, I really invite you to do that after today. Yeah, and with that, we've reached the end of our gathering for today. Yeah, I wanna invite folks to check out in the chat if you feel like doing that, a word, a phrase, any gratitude you want to share for Kayla and Carmen. If you are looking at the Care Maybe document or at the slides, if there's anything in there that's resonating with you that you want to share into the chat, yeah, to check out now. And also invite anybody on the facilitation team if you want to share anything. As we say goodbye, please feel free also to do that.
Yeah, we like, sorry, I can speak for you a bit, Carmen. Is that okay? Cool. I got you. Yeah, we're really, really grateful to be doing this. It's kind of wild that like this is all wrapping up for us. Yeah, this is really important work to us, and the way that y'all are approaching it is like, I don't really like the word inspiring, but it like is really, is sort of like imagination breaking for what's possible and the potential. And that really, I think for a lot of us, like we can use some like gas put into our imaginations for what we deserve. So that's something that like is really meaningful to us. And like, we started this in 2020, and the fact that we are doing this with y'all and like talking about such important things is like, Carmen and I will absolutely like about it after, because we will be really excited. This is really, really cool. And thank you to all of you for like sharing space with us and also trusting us to do this work, because it's a big deal and it's not lost on us. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you both. And thank you everyone for sharing space with us tonight. I love that imagination breaking. I think everyone here has been part of that through all the ways that you've participated, as Karina said, the ways that we're able to see and hear, and also the ways that we weren't, and just you being here, and however you were. I was part of that. So thank you all. And Victoria will play some tunes as we leave the room. Hope you have a great night or morning or afternoon wherever you are. Take care, and we'll see you again soon.
You can't live. Thank you, guys. I enjoy interpreting for you. Just wanted to say.